Welcome to Sunday Brunch Live. I'm Tim Lovejoy.
I'm Simon Rimmer.
Joining us today, presenter Helen Skelton, Dragon's Den tycoon Deborah Mead, and comedian Tom Davis, singer-songwriter Rasheem Murphy, and today's music guest, Wet Wet Wet's Marti, Pellow and Graeme Clark. Welcome to the show, everybody. Is everybody happy this morning?
So far.
What a beautiful start to the show. That was the Ang Dance Company. Will be teaching us the classical Indian dance of Cat Hack later on today. We will be trying that, won't we?
It will be just that good as well.
It was great. Your pronunciation was really good there, actually. I was so quite amused at that somehow. What's the name of the dance?
Cat Hack.
You got it. Yeah. Somebody told you in the ear, didn't they?
No.
No, they didn't.
Marti, consider I can basically not understand a word you say to me.
Okay.
You're command of the English language.
I shall communicate you only using the power of mime for the rest of the show.
Well, we're discussing that later on, actually, because we've got someone in who's going to be talking about mime and whether we'd be able to to do that.
Interesting.
Telepathy later on, I hope.
Interesting.
Anyway, dance. Yes. I used to be a dancer, is that true?
That is true. I wasn't very good at ballet because I was a bit of a plodder, but I used to do a lot of tap. Got invited to the Ken Dodd Tap Awards once.
Oh, how about that?
Invitation only.
Did you know Ken Dodd's dad's dogs died?
Did he?
No, does he? We'll move on from that.
Not one little snigger there, Tim.
In Liverpool, they'd have laughed, wouldn't
they? Yeah, they would. They're laughing now.
Are you all right today, by the way? Because you do know Stephen Gerrard retired yesterday, don't you? Were you aware of that?
It was his
He did retire from football, retired from Liverpool.
Yeah.
Yeah. Did everyone see that yesterday, Marti?
Yes.
Did you see that?
Very good. And I wonder if he's retiring his haircut as well. It's lasting for 20 years.
That's what they said, same haircut.
Yes.
I'm a little bit down.
Is he the best Liverpool player ever?
It's him or King Kenny.
Ah, yes. Hey, come on.
You know, they're the top two. And then I think if I had to go third, I'd go Robbie Fowler.
Oh, controversial.
Yeah. I think he'd go third.
Eagles
in the top 10, not quite there. Yeah, maybe 110.
Okay. All right. So how long did you dance for? Were you ever going to be a pro dancer?
No, I wasn't good enough. I enjoyed it, but it's quite serious. Well, you know, because you've done so much dancing, they're quite
serious. Well, I've seen you dance, and you are blinking brilliant.
I think I am.
We did a Let's Dance for Comic Relief together.
Oh yeah, we did.
And
yeah.
She scared the living daylights out of me because I just thought, oh my god, this is real. They can actually dance.
Yeah, but Skelton doesn't do anything by half measures though.
She's brilliant. Effort,
that's the thing.
Yeah. Good dancer, Tom.
Amazing. That's pretty much what I do. On Saturday nights down in Croydon High Street, you can see me busting up and down like that. Yeah.
Rasheen, are you
doing a lot of mum dancing lately?
Yeah.
A lot of this. Yeah. Come on, have a dance for your mum. Don't be embarrassed.
All right. Okay. Good. Well, today we're talking about things that make you happy. Last week, the Huffington Post created a list of things that supposedly make us happy. Sometimes it's the smallest wins throughout the day that cheer us up. What's on the list?
Well, we've got when the weatherman gets it right. Okay. When the sun shines and you're not at work. Yeah. Cat videos, obviously. Finding free Wi-Fi. Finding a tenner in your pocket. All of those work for me.
That's
it, I think.
Okay.
Yeah.
So for today's photo call out, we want to know all about the little or big things that make you happy. We've got some here. We've got some from the viewers, haven't we, as well?
No, we're going to do our guests first of all.
We
are. Yeah.
Okay, good.
It was changed just at the top of the show.
Good.
You know, Mel came out, she was chatting to us.
Was she talking
to us? That's what she was talking to us. Yeah. You were on your phone.
Yeah,
that's what Mel would do. Then. She was telling us what we changed. Yeah. Right. So this is Helen's. Oh, that's nice. Where's that?
That's my garden. So I like it when you can have your breakfast outside. It feels like you're abroad, doesn't it?
That is. Where is your garden? What part of the world is your garden in?
In Stockton Heath, near Warrington.
Right, OK, that's beautiful.
That was my dog.
Is the weather always like that up there?
Always.
Always like that.
Never grew up north.
Costa del Warrington.
Yeah. Exactly, yeah.
Deborah, this is you. Oh, yours.
Yeah.
Aww. So what makes you happy? Your farm?
Yeah, actually, animals. I like, you know, when I'd spend a lot of time talking to people, at people, maybe, but actually just, you know, silence and just being around the animals. I love it.
And how are the ducks which go with their hind legs and walk?
Oh, the Indian runner duck. Indian runner duck.
She's got these ducks which stand up.
They come out of their houses in the morning.
Very good.
That's
better than you, Mickey
Mouse. Have you seen them?
No.
They get out of the house in the morning and they all line up and they don't move. They just stand there like this and say, right, we ready? off we go. And then they just run around the garden. A bit Benny Hill-like, to be fair, but it's good.
Have you ever seen, you've got to see footage of that. Ducks and the hind legs on it, it's brilliant. Marti, what makes you happy? We've got this picture.
Oh, well, I saw that yesterday. I was walking and it's a letterbox and someone had written that, love letters only. And I thought, you know, that's fantastic, you know, because there's not enough. We don't write letters as much as what we used to because everybody lives in the cyber world and it's all emails. And when I get a letter, I love it. I love letters. And that's just, it was great. I thought, okay. So I'm going to send them a letter.
That's good.
It's like good.
That's very good.
It's a good idea to write a letter, isn't it?
Yeah. Well, you realise you're going to be inundated with letters now.
That's good, yes. Well, if the postal service gets up to speed, then maybe I'll receive them.
But, Marti, does this come from the fact that fan letters don't exist anymore? Do people still send fan letters?
Aye, absolutely. And you receive letters and it's good. And when you know, sometimes they're very poignant and you can, you know, you go back to them, you reflect on them and you can save them if they're powerful.
You save your fan letters,
huh? I've got them posted all over my toilet walls, everywhere.
I read this thing once that Tracy Emin used to, for a prize, I can't remember how much it was, sell. She would write you 4 letters a year if you paid her.
For a prize?
Before
she was famous. And she worked in the shop. Anyway, I'll move on from that.
Graeme, duck thing again. I love the duck thing. I love the duck thing. That's great.
Is your feet good?
Graeme, this is your picture. Makes you happy.
Well, this is Archie Gemmell's goal in the 1978 Argentina World Cup. And, I think it won goal of the tournament.
It's a great goal. And there's King Kenny alongside him.
Amazing
as well,
goal, yeah.
Against Holland.
Against Holland, yes. We won it 3-2 and Holland went on to be in the final, you know, so it was the only time that we were ever up for winning the World Cup. I like it.
It was one of the great goals of all time.
It was amazing, man. It still fills me with joy when I see it. And I saw that picture down in, actually in Croydon. And, I offered the guy a tenner.
Scotland haven't scored a goal since, have they?
It's not really, man. it's tough times.
But, I love the World Cup. You know, when the World Cup comes along, don't we? But we always seem to be home before our postcards.
Yeah. I mean, that's mystic football days, you know what I mean? Nowadays, you know, I love football and all that, but I mean, in those days, I was a teenager, man, you know.
It's not as good as it was in our day.
Yeah, that's right.
Well, Shane, what about you? We got your picture here. Things make you happy.
Pink gaffer tape makes me happy. Especially when I'm a bit bored and waiting for everybody to get their act together in rehearsals.
That's good.
I make my own
stuff.
Millinery.
That looks painful.
Incredible.
Anyway, send your pictures and messages into us. I'll do duck impressions, great.
There has to be pictures either today, so you can send in kind of, you know, just things and we'll read out ones that make you happy as well. Mel said that as well to us when she came out.
Did she?
Yeah.
Who's Mel? Send them to at SundayBrunchC4 or SundayBrunchChannel4.com. What's on the menu today, Simon?
She's first in the kitchen. We're doing a charred corn and asparagus salad with a yoghurt dressing. Nice if it's a nice sunny day today. English asparagus season, get a bit of that on the go. Marti and Graeme are making coconut salmon goujons with a red curry dipping sauce. Those are nice. Posh fish fingers, basically. Tim, you and I are making lamb rump with a Greek salad, bulgur wheat salad. Obviously, you could use couscous if you want. I hate couscous, so I'm using bulgur wheat. And then in the show, Tom and Deborah, we are making a lemon sponge with blueberries. That's a nice summery cake. Hey, guest chef, first time on the show, Vivek Singh. He is fantastic, and he's making beetroot halva spring rolls with iced double cream and cloves. Look at that.
Not only that, we'll be busting brain myths with Dr. Hannah Critchlow. Food writer Helen Graves gives us a history lesson on the humble sandwich. And Wet Wet Wet's Marti and Graeme perform live at the end of the show, which I'm looking forward to.
Yes, indeed. After the break, we're cooking charred corn and asparagus salad with Rasheed. See you soon.
Just enough water. We just have to have far too much water.
But why don't we make pasta ever on the show?
It gets a bit boring to make. It's great.
I don't think he can make it.
Is he watching his waistline?
Sounds like he can't make it.
Are you watching your
waistline? That's what it sounds like to me.
You're not going to tempt me, love. This is what we had in the script.
Come on,
this morning.
Let's make some ravioli.
It's boring. I think it's boring telling. It was just so annoying.
I don't know, because we could do the bit. Yeah, but that's good. You put it all out.
I just don't think it's exciting telling.
We can make a nice spinach and ricotta ravioli.
Oh, moving on.
Try putting some couscous in it.
I don't.
Parsley and couscous, see, there's a combo.
See, couscous makes me shudder. There's something wrong with couscous.
Well,
it's wrong.
I love couscous.
I find couscous very arrogant.
Love it.
An arrogant thing.
It is arrogant, Tommy, absolutely right.
I just think it just sits there, you put a bit of water on it.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've no respect for anyone.
I have.
Quinoa. No. Quinoa's a good thing.
Quinoa.
It takes a bit of effort, you throw a bit of stuff in it, you improvise.
Yeah.
Not couscous.
Does it blow your stomach?
What, quinoa?
No.
Oh, couscous.
Bulgur wheat and all that.
Everything blows.
Bulgur's good. We've got a bit of that later.
You got that.
Now you're talking a proper grain. Couscous. It's budgie food.
Anyway, after the break.
So wait a minute. You didn't listen. You know, if we haven't got this kind of worms, it's time to purge my soul.
Knock out flow, that is. Yeah. I never watched it, but wow. Yeah.
You on live TV too. Yeah. That was just below that bell.
I wanted nothing more than Tim to be my champion and win. And you did a casserole.
Do you know what beat me though? I can't remember his name now. Who was it? Gary Lucy. He did handmade pasta. And I remember walking past him. So quiet.
That's better. That's better.
Yeah.
That's better. That's what's making it work.
Dramatic and artistic. Yeah. You had a gig last night at the Roundhouse.
I did.
How was it?
Well, I hate to big myself up, but it was brilliant.
Is that a good venue to play? It must be great.
It is a good venue.
So what you've got is that lovely British asparagus, nice fresh lady. Flavour in there. Dig in, don't be polite, ladies and gentlemen. We've got loads more asparagus, so we want a bit of that. Do you like the look of that? Hello, Skelton.
Is there anything you don't want to eat because you're pregnant? I was like, I'm eating everything in a minute. That is good. Very good.
Thank you. It's good.
The stirring bit, that's the best bit.
Let me
have a taste.
For all tastes of the British recipes, of course, head to the website channel4.com/Sunday Brunch. And don't forget, if you cook a recipe, post a picture with it and send it in, let us know you get on. After the break, we're giving Katak Dancing a twirl, and there's a murder to solve with Tom and Deborah Ceci.
And Wet, Wet, Wet's Marti and Graeme sing live at the end of the show.
Now, gypsy lady's lost her soul, and she's so scared of growing old. But words don't age for me, she turns to gold.
I missed it,
Welcome back to Sunday Brunch Live. Just about to cook with the boys here, Wet, Wet, Wet. And before we do, today we want to know the everyday things that make you happy, however small they might be.
For instance,
some.
Matt from North Yorkshire says meeting his childhood hero makes him a happy man.
Who's that? I can't
see. Hulk Hogan.
Hulk Hogan.
That would make you happy.
I would.
Yeah, that would really make you happy.
Look at his skin colour. That's mad, isn't it?
But it really, it's the shape of the tash. It really brings it out, you know. That's a look that I think you could possibly pull off yourself.
Me? You think I could do that?
Aye,
you do.
You know, the tash, yeah. I mean,
he thinks I could.
Do what? I think that's a really, really good
you
idea.
You do as well.
Yeah. It's a really, really good idea.
Everyone thinks I should do it.
if you think Tim should grow a Hulk Hogan
really?
Mustache, just tweet into the show.
Yeah. Or possibly we could get we could hire one from the Hulk and you could apply.
Yes.
And then you wouldn't have to go the process of growing it, so you were instantly there with it.
We can probably have that by the end of the show. We're on for 19 hours. Marina from Kent is happy that she kept her record collection.
Ooh.
Nice.
I got rid of mine.
I really regret it.
I'm regretting it now.
I don't regret getting rid of the CDs, but I regret the vinyl.
Yeah.
Vinyl was great.
Gatefold sleeves, that's what I miss on vinyl. Barbara says she was happy when she met a certain someone at the footy.
Wait a minute.
Look at that. Champions. There we are, together.
Cousins.
Just when I thought that was a little bit annoying, that picture. And finally, homemade pasta makes Annie and very happy indeed.
That would make me happy. Can you guys make pasta?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, right, we're going to make, we're going to do something, so basically doing posh fish fingers. So we've got a piece of salmon, then we've got some red curry paste, a bit of olive oil, some coconut cream, a dried chilli, some vinegar, a little bit of water just to let it down, some bread that we've toasted, or you can use stale bread. Then we've roasted off some tomatoes, some peppers, some onion and some garlic. Then we've got stuff to kind of roll it in. All right, so first job. Graeme, let's have you doing this. So what we need our fish fingers. So basically cut the salmon into pieces that kind of size.
Sure.
Okay. And then what we do, we've got here, we've got some flour, we've got some egg. You carry on, I'll do this a little bit. Flour, some egg, and we've got half breadcrumbs and half desiccated coconut. So, Marti, if you want, so we've got the flour there, then we've got the egg. Then if you rub those together.
Yes.
Yeah.
Now, could you do this for talking sake, say, with couscous?
No, you absolutely couldn't. So if you do that, and then as you get in there, yeah, you'll feel it in your fingers.
Oh, that's, that was a great link, you know what I mean? Yeah, you really wouldn't want to do this with your toes, would you?
So we mix that together. So what you get is you go, now, when you deep fry these, you need to make sure that it's you drop the temperature. Normally you'd fry about 180, drop it to 160, so you don't burn the coconut.
Well, okay. I,
so, which obviously we know. Yeah. So as Graeme does that, so Marti, what we do then, the process is we go. We go.
There's a lot of kerfuffling going on here.
It's my new kitchen. So we go into flour.
Oh, aye.
Yeah, like that. Pat off the excess.
Aye.
Then we go into egg.
Nice.
Shake off the excess. Then into our breadcrumb and coconut mix. Yeah. And then you can just leave them in there. Okay.
Nice,
beautifully done. Great.
That's something nice.
Help yourselves.
How's your cooking, Graeme? You any good in the kitchen?
I'm not really, but I enjoy it. I enjoy it. I do a bit of pasta occasionally.
Yeah, we never do it on this show. Apparently, it's quite hard.
Yeah, apparently, yeah.
I find it easy.
I've taught you over the years. This is going to go on and on and on. This is
actually just sense
it. Until I give in and we kind of do it.
Yeah, I mean, you should just go with it, you know.
Yeah, I know. Sure.
So it's easier sometimes just to give in.
Aye.
Yeah, that is the reality of it. Yeah.
Ravioli, let's make it. Because then we get to do with the bit
of the wee thing, it cuts it.
And then we get to do the fork thing around the edge. That's nice. That's good. That's good. That's good television.
Blanche. We love about blanching.
Just think of the close-up to that. So we're all going around the edges.
What filling?
I don't know. I think meat. Or we could do spinach and ricotta.
Crab's always nice.
I think spinach and ricotta and a nice sage, you know, butter sage sauce over.
Oh, hey.
Something traditional.
I'm not the one that's doing it.
They know I feel on the show, Graeme. Right, so then what we do, so we get these, and then we go into our deep fryer. And all we're looking to do, we're really looking to cook the edges of this, because you still want the salmon to be a nice little bit pink in the middle. And if you don't want to do it with salmon, you can do it with any white fish, really. Or you can even do it with prawns, to be honest. And as I say, we drop the temperature of that just a little bit, just so it doesn't burn. Let's do that last one. OK. So that's the fishy bit. So those deep fried. Then we're going to make the sauce. So, like I said, what we've done, we've roasted off the tomato, we've roasted off the onion, we've roasted off the garlic. You all right? You can share two times. Sorry. Right, so we've roasted these off, and then this just makes a simple dipping sauce. So what we do, we get our peppers. Now, I'm going to peel these. We've roasted them. So, Marti, what we need to do is just pull away the skin on the peppers. It's not crucial, but it just makes for a smoother sauce. So once you've done that...
That looks really easy to do. You're doing it with such conviction. Maybe you should soldier on with the entire...
Get working, Pellow. Get working.
All right,
so
okay.
All of that goes into there. Then, Graeme, your next job. So the bread is going to give us some texture into this sauce. Yeah,
nice.
So basically, crumble the bread, and that goes in as well.
Oh, aye, OK.
Nice.
Oh, nice, nice.
Like
so, there, you're watching.
Yeah, how are you
going? Absolutely, yeah, absolutely good. Amazing.
It's good.
What's your take on the Tommies? The tomatoes?
Yeah.
Do you skin them as well?
Well, no, let's not bother.
Okay.
If you want it to be, you want to make it sort of perfectly, beautifully smooth, then yeah, but you know what? This is a dipping sauce. We're basically doing posh fish fingers, so you don't need to worry. Now, what I'm doing, I've got a bit of coconut cream that we're going to grate. This will give us a little bit of creamy smoothness into all of this, okay? Tim, you could pop in to there. We've got red chai curry paste, then we've got a little bit of water and a little bit of vinegar. Okay. Just everything goes into that process.
All right. I'll do that.
And then...
I'll do that.
Oh, maybe.
this will come to the other light. Now, these, so look, once we get into this stage, we're not far off. So you see, we're not burning the coconut. That's the important thing.
Okay, right.
If you had this really high, this on 200, you would burn the coconut before the breadcrumbs were caught, before the fish were caught, and then you have a horrible bitter flavour, which we don't want, OK? Next up, Greg, just snap that dried chilli again into our little sauce there, and we then add our coconut cream into that. That all goes in as well.
Why do you put a dried chilli in?
Well, you could put a fresh one in, but the dried one really just gives us a little bit of a stronger flavour. So what you get with the ones that aren't dried, if you had something like a Scotch bonnet or a normal kind of long red chilli, you get fruitiness. I don't want fruitiness. I've got enough fruitiness in there with the tomato.
Okay.
So what we're doing is we're getting another level of flavour. So we've got the dry flavour, which gives you a kind of deeper one. So, next thing, lid on and puree that, please, Timothy.
OK.
So our fish fingers are done. So these are lovely. This
look
is great.
Great, man.
Look great, man. This really is a good snack. You know, this is kind of something that you would kind of do. You could have smaller pieces, so you could do little fancy food. You know, you're both celebrities. You're used to eating.
That's
food,
like the Rolls Royce of fish fingers.
Proper one. So, but if you had, you could do little ones. So when you have your fancy parties with all your celebrity friends around, obviously people only ever eat small food.
Yeah.
Make them smaller.
Hey, this would be good tour food, wouldn't it? Put it on the catering, on the rider.
On the rider.
Yeah, I like it.
Have you sorted the catering yet?
You've got to get your rider right. Got to get it right, you know, and it's assorted meats from around the globe.
Yeah.
Most cheeses that are based on a deer. Like, you go first.
Yeah.
Things that, and obviously getting the sandwich presented to you at the correct time.
Exactly.
Or the crust, you know, the turn up.
Oh, that's nice. Oh, that's nice. Now, the Hulk Hogan thing has actually gone a little bit kind of crazy. And we've actually had someone sent an impression of what they think you and Mark have sent this in.
Tell
you
what.
Nice.
Yeah, that works, doesn't it?
It does. What, the frightening thing, it does.
I tell you what, that absolutely
works.
Like kind of son of Hogan.
That is working, but maybe that's just a male perspective. I wonder what the ladies think about that. Would that suit me?
It looked a little bit like you were foaming around the mouth. You look quite European.
Is that a good look? European, I like that.
I think you're very handsome.
You could carry that off though, Tim, you know.
Yeah, well, should I do it then? Definitely.
Yeah.
Everyone thinks I should do it, yeah.
Would you wear it in full wrestling gear?
Oh, yeah.
Like the whole thing?
Yeah, bandana and all that. Yeah. Saves the old hair problem going on.
Don't draw focus.
We'll have to wear the wig.
So we've got, here is our lovely little Thai dipping sauce. So you've got a bit of fire from the red Thai cook, but not too much. You don't want to be too overpowering. Then we've got a little bit more hot sauce. You want to spruce that up a little bit. We have a little bit of mint on there, which is lovely and fresh. Then we have some lime. So we're going to do two things with the lime.
Come over.
One, we're going to serve a little slice of it. It looks pretty. But then also, what I always like to do, anything that's fishy, a little squeeze of acidity over the top always works for me. So just before we serve, we have a bit of that goes on there, and that will bring it all to life.
Oh,
so it's not. There we go. Dip in, have a little bite, smear a little bit of the dipping sauce on the top, and see what you think. Good brain food as well, Hannah.
Why are you pointing that at me?
For your soon to arrive baby,
well,
good brain food.
It's a good point.
Nice. Nice.
Delicious.
Lovely. Yeah, they've been deep fried. Posh fish fingers. For all those sandwich recipes, head to the website channel4.com/brunch. After the break, the history of the humble sandwich takes centre stage. And we chat more to Rashid. See you soon.
Wet, wet, wet. The Big Picture Tour 2016. See Wet, Wet, Wet live throughout the UK. For ticket details, go to wetwetwet.co.uk.
She used to be...
Welcome back to Sunday Brunch Live. That was the Vaccines, who are with us next week. Joining us today are Helen Skelton, Deborah Meaden, Tom Davis, Roisin Murphy, Marti Pellow and Graeme Clark. Is everybody having a good morning this morning?
Yes.
Good. Yeah. Well, we've been asking you for everyday things that make you happy, however small they might be. We've had some more in. Alison McCumbrie is happy when she spends time with her dog, Oscar.
Nice Oscar.
That is a great picture, isn't it?
Sure,
it's just like a guinea pig. Relieved from Wiltshire is happy when she's going to see Wet, Wet, Wet.
Oh,
that's a picture.
That's the happiest person in the world. Genuinely, it's the happiest person in the world. I'm going to be in a state of ecstasy where I'm like that.
And Clover Sheffield is happy when she waves at a train driver and he beeps back. Yeah, that's...
Yeah,
that's a good one. And finally, Paul from Scotland is happy when he's learning to make gnocchi the proper Italian way. You see, you're in luck, because we're going to make gnocchi on the show in a few weeks. You hate gnocchi, don't you?
No, I don't actually hate gnocchi. Oh. The first time I had it was when you made it.
Yeah.
And it was on a show we used to do years ago.
Together.
And it was a bit...
Yeah.
But without...
Is that a technical term?
Yeah. I don't know how to spell that, but but now I've learned to love it.
Embrace it. Mm. Embrace the gnocchi love.
It's not pasta, though. It's potato, isn't it?
It's a potato pasta, yeah.
Oh, so what does it have apart from potato in it?
You've got potato, egg and flour, fundamentally. And then what you do is you kind of mix them together, roll it out, and then the joy with gnocchi, of course, when it goes into the water, when it rises to the surface, it's cooked.
Do you know it's cooked?
Yeah.
Isn't that the same with pasta, when you make ravioli?
In just a moment, today's guest chef, Vivek Sikimex, is Sunday Brunch Davey. But first, here's what else is still to come on today's show.
We're busting myths of the brain with Dr. Hannah Critchlow. Simon's cooking lamb rump with Greek-style salad. And Wet, Wet, Wet's Marti and Graeme play live at the end of the show.
Now Gypsy lady's lost her soul and she's so scared of growing old. But words don't age for me, she turns to gold. Gypsy girl...
Yeah, have a little sniff of that. So now they've been roasted, it gets that big, heady smell.
Let's see how...
That's some kind of
traditionally, halwa, we'd make a halwa with anything, you know, with semolina, with polenta. You could make a halwa with beetroot, carrots, almonds, and, you know, so on and so forth. I think of this as a slightly grown-up halwa. It's not a kid's halwa because it's beetroot. And, you know, and I gather you like beetroot.
Beetroot for me is, I think, is probably my favourite ingredient. I think the versatility, I mean, this being a great illustration of it, you know, that you can use it in sweet dishes, savoury dishes.
Correct, yeah.
It pickles well, it roasts well. There are very few things that don't taste better with beetroot. Beetroot and cheese combined.
Love beetroot, don't you?
You know, you love beetroot. I'm not sure if you've had it as a dessert before. Let's see what you think.
Well,
you
see, the thing is, I think, you know, I'll quite often put grated beetroot in a chocolate cake. Same way you can put courgette or carrots, so you're getting that, you know, that earthy quality.
Yeah.
And it will hold moisture. They look beautiful. So do you need to add...
I have some news from the table.
Oh, yes?
Yeah. Some news. Helen's got some news from the
table.
Helen,
what's your news, Helen?
David Weir says that beetroot shots help him, you know, do what he does, and that's why he was so successful in the Olympics, because he always had shots of beetroot.
Right.
There you go. So they're helpful
there you go.
As well.
And yet another reason.
Apparently they're good for getting oxygen around your body or something, aren't they? Like those little power shots of beetroot juice.
But when you after the journey of the said beetroot juice, you do panic.
Trust you to bring the level of it down.
No, I'm just following in the information, because somebody might go on that journey with the beetroot juice and feel have a good workout and then feel that they're dying.
Right. Yes. So we have our beautiful arms.
Beautiful.
Like that.
Thank you. That's beautiful.
That's amazing.
Ladies and gentlemen, have a little taste of that.
You've had a bit of the scrap ends. That's the
digging.
Best bit.
Thank you. Lovely to have you on the show.
It's a pleasure.
Thank you, my friend.
I better just have a bit more.
And for all those interested in calls, head to the website channel4.com/Sunday Brunch.
Try that. That is unbelievable.
After the break, Dr. Hannah Critchlow blows our minds with science, and we chat to the wets. Marti and Graeme, see you soon. In just a moment, we'll chat to Marti Pellow and Graeme Clark. But first, let's take a look at some of the great work they did as well.
Show me one more sound, give me one more time.
Yeah, we're joined by half of Wet, 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 Marti and Graeme. What do you think when you see the old videos? Do you love it?
Absolutely love them. Love them. Because there was Temptation, we had the chance that we went to New Orleans and did that. And it was the time of Mardi Gras was happening, so we got to experience that. These were things that were, you know, that we could only wish about or saw on TV, and then we were there doing that sort of thing. And obviously, you wish you'd moisturised a wee bit more as well. But it's great. These are great things that we share with the nation. You know, when we have dodgy clothes and dodgy haircuts, we can't stick those pictures, unfortunately, in a drawer, never to be seen again. We share.
But you're a proper band, aren't you? As in, you met when you were kids and grew up together and have gone through everything together.
We did. We met at school and, you know, we started writing songs pretty early on and, you know, the plan was to always kind of try and get a record deal, you know what I mean? Even as a 15-year-old kind of arrogant wee guy, man, you know, it was like, yeah, let's not play the pubs. Let's try and write our own songs, you know, and we managed to do it, or that's debatable, depending if you like it or you don't, you know, but, you know, that's what we ended up doing, and, we sort of, you know, we come back every couple of years, come back together and dust down the old songs, and, you know, I'm forever trying to kind of, as a songwriter, you always want to write new songs, you know, but when you go out and tour as well, you know, people kind of say, don't play as the new album, man. Give us Lovers All Around and Sweet Little Mystery and we can go home happy, you know? Yeah. So, I mean, you know, the music business is in a kind of strange place at the moment, but, you know, I like bands that kind of go out there and try and write new songs and try and put new music out there, because that's the lifeblood
of us. But when you started and you kind of, you know, and you're practicing in your mum's house, how quick did it go from kind of being a band, one, to sort of thinking, you know what, we're all right here, to then actually being signed and starting to make a living from it? How far?
It was like a couple of years. And the interesting thing about it was is that because we were doing like a couple of wee occasional gigs, and then it was like people had demo tapes, and then it kind of went from hand to hand, you know, and then suddenly we had like a little following of 200, then it was 500, and then it was 1,000, and you know, and then you know, record companies were kind of focusing quite heavily on Glasgow because of the tail end of the Postcard era with Orange Juice and Fire Engines and Joseph K, and we were kind of the next kind of bands that were coming through there with Hipsway, Love and Money, and Wet, 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 Hue and Cry, you know, so and Texas as well, you know, so there was a little kind of focus there that lots of record companies picked up on, and that was the start of your journey.
Was there ever a moment that you thought, oh, we've really made it now?
Absolutely. Madison Square Gardens or the Hollywood Bowl, and you know, or getting to go around the world, you know, on a song, number one albums, number one singles, and you go, yeah, that's great, because these are things that you just sit about wishing in your head, and that's the way, and when it pans out or other people subscribe to that vision, it's great.
It was funny, you know, I think, not really kind of all we've made it, but there was a time when, you know, we'd released the record, and in those days, you put the single out, and it had 3 or 4 weeks where it kind of bubbled under, you know. I mean, nowadays it's you get 1 week, man, you got to go high in the charts, man, or else it's gone. Mm-hmm. Then it kind of, you know, it would take 6 weeks to actually get in the top 40, you know. So I remember kind of going back to Glasgow, and we were in a chip shop, and we were getting a bag of chips, and the radio was on in the background. And I've got a wee built in radar, I think, you know, I can always kind of tell. That's Marty's voice, or more likely, that's my bass player. So I'm sitting listening, and I'm trying to tell the Italian Glaswegian, that's my record, and he's kind of going, what do you want? What do you want on your chips? I'm like, no, that's me on the radio. He's like, right, you want radio on your chips, head, you know? And that made me feel kind of, you know, I was like, yes. You know, the first time you hear your record on radio, you kind of think, I've arrived.
Or hearing it in a club for the first time.
Yeah.
You know, you hear it in a club and you think, oh, am I going to empty that dance floor? You know, when the people puts it on, they want your radar, and you're just like, you're watching, and then you see people engaging in it, and the circle's complete. You say, right, game on, here it is, that's what it is. It started off just you in a bedroom, you know, trying to make these songs, and then you see them go on the journey, and other people get into it.
So when you get together now to play again, do you get that wonderful warmth?
Is All Around. You know, that's a song that was phenomenally successful. And you know, there's enough time now that has passed with that where you look at it and go, I want to bring that out to play. You know, I want to play these songs. And it's great because, you know, if you're losing your audience, you just play certain cards. And you know? But to get back to Graeme about writing, you know, about new music is too, you know, hopefully we will be doing that, you know, because we're releasing a record, Picture This, which is a celebration of that record that's coming out. And we want to go back in the studio and write some new music so that we can show where we are at 50 as opposed to where we are at 20. Because you look at it different, you know, I'd like to think the more you do something, the better you become it.
Do you get new fans as well now? Because I had the guys suspend a on a while ago, and they were saying, like, you know, how they're quite surprised at how many new fans they've got, because they always expect, you know, the people who grew up with you will be there, and they've got a whole horde of new ones.
Yeah, but it's like your mum and dad's record collection's your first port of call. It was for me, I would imagine it would be for you all. Yeah. And so we've fallen into that category now. So it's like, you know, people are discovering our back catalogue and it's coming along to the shows, and you go, it's great because, you know, we'd meet some teenagers who are getting off in certain songs and they weren't born. And you go, well, that's great. That's great because your aim as songwriters is to make them timeless. Yeah. You know, and so something that goes on.
You know the passing of time when somebody comes up and you kind of know, oh, they're going to ask me for a picture or something, and they say, hey, listen, Graeme, can you sign this for my granny? No, my mum, my granny.
What, OK, then. So where are you touring, then? Where are the gigs?
All round the UK. We're going the Big Picture Tour. It's in February and March 2016. We're going, as I said, all over, starting... I don't know where we're starting, actually, but we're like the
it's
top of the country.
Plymouth?
Inverness to Plymouth, is like, you know, if you go on www.wetwet.co.uk, you'll find out all the information. You can sign up to our mailing list. I've got to say all this, Tim, because it's punishable by death if I don't, man, you know. But we're doing a gig in Coco next Wednesday for Nordoff Robbins charity, which we're involved in, and you can stream that live on wetwetwet.tv. All the information is on wetwetwet.co.uk. We're also releasing Picture This, as you talked about, the big picture box set, which is quite exciting for us. There's a DVD in there. I'm getting it the hard.
You've done well.
And we're going to shrink wrap some couscous to and just see how we can get inventive with that. Because I'm not going to hold it.
Thanks, guys. And you'll be singing Gypsy Girl at the end of the show.
Yes, please.
After the break, we're in the kitchen cooking lamb rump with Greek style bulgur wheat salad, not couscous. See you soon.
Oh, wow. Are we really doing this on telly? We are, aren't we? Or what are we going with? Inches or centimetres?
Where do you feel most comfortable?
Inches. Right, mine is... that's the wrong way around. Helen should be doing this, really. You don't, you know, this is sort of...
Why?
I don't know, it's sort of Blue Peter-y, isn't it?
Is it?
Right.
What did we decide?
An independent adjudicator.
That is
2.75 inches. I'll just put my little bit taller.
Oh, yours is definitely taller. Just over 3.1.
3.1. So you're winning so far, but I don't know how long this goes on to, because I suppose... Anyone got any advice for growing sunflowers?
Water and sun, I think.
Yeah.
Yes.
Show some love, conversations, talking.
Sing to them.
My granddad...
I feel like they're having a laugh with you.
My granddad... I think they might be taking the mickey out of us. My granddad always put tea on his, so I'm...
Not blood.
Blood? Why blood?
Well, because your family have a history of being horse slaughterers. I thought maybe your granddad was going to bring you some blood to kind of put on them.
No, when he was doing this, he was covered in horse blood. All drilling, down it.
This is back a long time ago. We did a thing about kind of ancestors. It turned out that Tim's family were all horse slaughterers. I've just got to turn my lamb over. You carry on wasting your time with that.
You must know about these things, having a farm.
Horse slaughtering or... I went rigid when you said that.
Right, that's the magic ingredient there, tea. That's it. That is going to make it. There you go.
You know, when you talk to them, does it have to be positive things that you say to them, or does it work the other way?
Oh, yeah.
So if I say, you're going nowhere, Carrotty sunflowers.
Carrot or stick.
Demotivate the flower.
Yeah.
Or carrot or stick, unless you grow longer.
Easy tiger.
Faster. I'm ripping you out.
Let's move away from the sun.
Okay.
Right, so...
I'm 97% certain it wasn't an alien spacecraft.
Really?
But
right.
It was shiny, it yeah. was moving, and yeah. it was in the sky, and I couldn't identify it. It wasn't an aeroplane, and it was a long way away, and it was moving. What was it? They always say it's a weather balloon, don't they?
Yeah, I mean, luckily, we have got Tom sitting around the table, and he is a UFO expert.
Yeah.
Tom,
what
did Tim see?
Probably a star, maybe. Probably a star.
It wasn't night.
It wasn't night, it was a day.
It was daytime, yeah, it was daytime.
Well, as a UFO expert, I can tell that aliens only come out at night. Like they never come out during the day.
I did say...
So much bad for their skin. You'll never see an alien with a tan. Unless it's fake.
I'm pretty certain it wasn't an alien. Pretty certain.
So if it was you think it was a bloke driving a UFO?
It's just, I don't know what it was. It was just something in the sky. It was just an unidentified flying object.
That's was it that really hot day where you've been drinking in the afternoon? You had a couple of ciders.
No, I was driving, actually. And if I wasn't driving, I'd have got my phone out and taken a really bad picture of it like people do with UFOs.
Yeah. Never a good picture, even with all this technology.
Like that. Some video.
That'd have been better if you were driving.
But you know when you saw it, and the natural thing, of course, is that you're going to doubt the fact, obviously, that it's an alien spacecraft. But then as you're going through your mind, you go, right, it's definitely not a plane.
Is it? I was looking at it thinking, what is that?
Yeah.
And then I thought, well, it's not an alien spacecraft, because I'm not stupid, am I, and they don't exist. And then as the day's gone on, as I say, on Friday I was 99% sure it wasn't an alien spacecraft. Today I'm 97% sure. So it's creeping up.
Right. So now you do actually believe in alien spacecraft?
No,
is that basically what you're saying?
No, I don't, because I'm 97% certain it's not an alien spacecraft. It was moving through the sky.
And where was this? Was this on the way back to leafy West London?
I think I was on the A40.
Okay. So, not the UFO hotspot that the A40 is.
But it was miles away, so it could have been, like, I don't know, it was a long way.
You were probably,
away.
Like, the only person on the road who saw it, because everyone else was going, oh, my God, look, it's Tim Lovejoy.
Migraine, just have a glass of water.
Your mum is probably right. Right,
I'm not just saying there's no such thing as aliens. I said, I'm not saying it's aliens. I just saw something. It wasn't an aeroplane or a helicopter. It was in the sky. And it wasn't a bird. And not many things are in the sky.
I believe you.
And it wasn't the sun either, or the moon. Right.
Right, so here we go. This is now cooked. It would probably do it with another minute. And as I say, what we'd like to do is let this rest. Mix those two together if you would, Tim. So put
this in this.
Yeah, put that into the bigger bowl. Give that a nice gentle move around. We'll also add some lovely peppery rocket into there as well. And just gently move that so we get this lovely salad. Then what we have, our delicious piece of lamb. You would really let this rest for a good kind of 3 or 4 minutes at least. Oh, that's not bad, actually. And you can see we're still nice and pink in that middle there. That is lovely. That's beautiful. That'll do me, that's fine. So what we do, and again, this is a really nice salad that you could have a great big bowl full of this and let everybody just join in
if
and
anyone
tuck
would
in
like
themselves.
To try this, they'd like to make
and then
the way
we have
over.
Our delicious bits of lamb on the top. And just a little bit more acidity on the top with some lovely yogurt sits there. That is pretty, pretty tasty. Helen, Deborah, Tom, have a little dig into that, see what you think. So it's fresh, it's tasty, it's summer salad-y.
For all of the recipes on today's show, head to the website channel4.com/sundaybrunch. And don't forget, if you do cook a recipe, pose for a picture with it and let us know, send it in.
Or if you see an alien. Yeah, alien cool. spacecraft, send those in.
I don't think it was an alien, Simon.
Not really. Not
you like?
Yes. We can't get near it for Tom.
After the break, we'll chat more to Helen. And if you drink a beer sample first, here's a reminder how to enter this week's competition.
Welcome back to Sunday Brunch. Still to come this morning, Wet's Marti, Pellow and Graeme Clark sing live. There they are. what are we doing now, Simon?
Well, before we do pudding...
Yeah. ...machine to play us out this week. Mm-hmm. We're Gypsy Girl. Where it's Marti Pellow and Graeme Clark. We'll see you all 9:30 next Sunday. You have a great day today, OK?
Hey, you have a great day, Tim.
Thank you very much. See you next week. Bye-bye. Bye.
Before my
my time, I sang a song to a friend of mine about a girl working for a town. I didn't know that gypsy girl, but I knew about a kind of thrill. Her love was cheap and always up for sale. Now who picture this? I was alone. Gypsy girl. Now gypsy lady's lost her soul, and she's so scared of growing old. But words don't age for me, they turn to gold. Gypsy girl with raven hair holds my hopes into the air. She's the one that never seemed to care. Now picture this, I was alone. When I fell in love, I was alone. Ooh, with my gypsy girl. Yeah. Gypsy girl, sing. La 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 la. La 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 la. La 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 la. Sing with me, la 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 la, la 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 la, la 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 la. Now, ooh, picture this, I was alone. When I fell in love, I was alone. Gypsy girl. Yeah, gypsy girl.